Hey, welcome to the Presbyterian Church of Lawrenceville Online. My name is Kyle, and I'm one of the pastors here at the church. Whether you're a longtime member or friend of our congregation or a first-time guest with us, we are so glad that you have joined us for worship this morning. We're online, and so I encourage you to take advantage of that chat feature there to the right of your screen. If you're viewing this service on a mobile device, that chat feature will be down below. Someone from our church will be online during our live stream looking to engage with you. If you have any comments or concerns, prayer requests or needs, we do encourage you to share those with us. We'll try to respond to all of those as they come in. You can use that chat feature for just such a thing. If you'd like, you can also email any requests to our Associate for Pastoral Care Ministries, Jill Cifelli. Know that we continue to pray with and for one another. If you're sharing requests in the comments publicly, just a reminder, please don't include last names so that we can maintain one another's privacy. Engage with this service. Use the Facebook reactions as the service goes. Consider sharing your comments throughout the service. Like this post or share our video on Facebook. Even you might consider starting a watch party. It's never been easier to invite your friends and your family members to church. And so we encourage you to do that. Also, sing loudly. All of the words to the songs that we'll include in our worship service will be there on the screen for you. So sing like nobody's watching. All right. And finally, several of you have asked about how you might support PCOL during these times. And it's never been easier to do that. We encourage you to visit our website, pclawrenceville.org. And there at the top right-hand corner of the webpage, you'll see a blue button labeled Donate. Go ahead and click there and you can give a contribution to our church. Whether you're watching us live or you're catching up with us later in the week on Facebook or YouTube, we are so glad that you've decided to join us. And we look forward to worshiping God together. Good morning. I'm going to take a moment and welcome you all to worship, whether you are here with us in person, it's good to see you, or whether you're joining us virtually on Facebook or on Zoom. How does it feel for those of you here in person? Good. And is it strange to know that you are also gathering hybridly with a bunch of other people virtually? We are a different kind of community this morning, but I think the church has always been a different kind of community, hasn't it? If you are worshiping with us this morning, if you're worshiping with us virtually, please download the order of worship. I want to make sure that you get your hands on that document. That will help you to participate with us in worship. But there are also a number of announcements and things in there that we want to commend to you this morning. If you're worshiping with us in person, hopefully you have an order of worship. And you didn't sneak in. If you did, just make sure you raise your hand and Roberta or Brant will get you an order of worship. If you're worshiping with us in person, just a few notes about what this all looks like. We do ask that you keep your masks on throughout the service, but do participate in the service. Feel free to participate in the liturgy, the responsive liturgy, and I'm going to even go as far as to say, even sing along quietly. No soloists, right? No soloists. We've got one. Well, Bev, I don't know if you want to be called a soloist, but here you are. Appreciate you being here. We're not passing offering plates this morning. There are places, if you would like to give an offering this morning, you can always give online, but if you'd like to drop off a check or cash this morning, there is an offering plate here in the front, and there's one in the back. So as you leave, feel free to do that, and that is totally fine. We ask that we all can maintain physical distancing while in worship, and please don't gather indoors around everybody to catch up. I know it's, you know, the need, right? That our church family, we're back together. How can we connect? For those of you who are here and don't have access to technology readily available with you, we invite you to join us in the lounge immediately after worship to participate in our congregational meeting. More on that in just a moment. All right, for all of us here in person or gathering virtually, there's a few announcements that I want to share with you. The first is that this week is the final week of our Amend series. If you've not participated in that yet, this is the week to do it. It's okay if you've missed the other three. This week, we're inviting the executive producer and co-creator of the Amend series, Robe, I forget his last name. It's in the order of worship. But he's going to be with us and will join us for a conversation about the series. It's sort of don't want to miss this opportunity. The link to register is in the chat and in your order of worship. You can find that also online. Also, you'll notice there's an announcement there. We mentioned last week about the Trenton Thunder baseball game. Actually, the Trenton Thunder are not playing, I've been told. I guess they've moved. But the stadium is still here, and they're inviting other baseball teams to come, so we're going to go. Tickets are cheap if you get them through the church, and there's a fireworks show afterwards. It's going to be Thursday, July 15th. If you're interested, please contact Alicia Morrison for more information. Next Sunday, we'll be gathering outdoors for worship. We acknowledge that for some, gathering indoors is still risky, or you know, there are still folks who are cautious about that. And so we are committed to gathering outdoors when we can throughout the summer as well, and especially for worship. So next Sunday, worship outdoors in the cemetery. We're going to have pop-up canopies and all that to try to create shade for everybody. Come, bring a chair, register online, or call the church office. We would love to have you join us. We'll also be honoring our high school graduates next week and presenting them with gifts on behalf of the church. So please do join us for that. And the moment you've all been waiting for, right? It's been at least 3 weeks since our last ice cream social. So we're overdue for free ice cream and fellowship. There is going to be a link in the chat. There's information. There will be information. I don't think it made the order of worship, but information about how to register will be on our website and in the e-news this week for those of you who are in person. Please sign up for that. Come out. Last time we had about 60 folks that came out. It was a great time to catch up. And gosh, those ice cream sandwiches were so good. So come have some ice cream, catch up with us. We'd love to have you join us. That's going to be Saturday, June 6th from 3 to 4 p.m. just out here in the parking lot. And if it's raining, the rain date is Sunday, June 27th. This morning, if you worshiped with us last week, you might remember. Today is the day that we receive our special offering for the Samaritan Baptist Church in Trenton to support their summer children's program and children's ministry. And so that program provides education and sports and crafts and all kinds of opportunities for children in the Trenton area, not just those who participate in the church. And it's free to all of those who participate. It's a great opportunity, and it's because of folks like you all who are generous with your gifts to support that. So this morning, in addition to our normal offering, we'll also receive this special offering to support that program. If you are online, if you're worshiping with us, you can click the blue donate button and it will bring you to the to give an offering, a general offering. You can use that drop-down menu and find Samaritan Baptist Church special offering to give that way. If you're here in person and you'd like to write a check, just write Samaritan Baptist Church in the memo line and that will suffice. Two last announcements. Each week we lift up a moment for generous living. And, you know, I know that we've lifted up our musicians and music team in the past, but since that time we've had a sort of a surge in other folks like Bev and Jessica and Jan and Tim and Katie Stanek, who have come to lead us in our hymns, right? This new need that has come out of this pandemic for which we are grateful. And so Bev and Jessica and Jan and Tim and Katie, we are grateful for your generosity to our community and the ways in which you are serving us and helping to lead us in worship. So thank you for that. And finally, the call for the annual congregation meeting and the special corporation meeting immediately following worship this morning. The annual meeting of the congregation and a special meeting of our corporation of the church will be held this morning, Sunday, June 13th at 11 a.m. by Zoom. Annual reports will be received from the church organizations. The pastor's terms of call will be presented for approval. The nominating committee will present nominations for elders, deacons, and trustees, as well as members of the auditing committee and the nominating committee. Additional nominations may be made from the floor by any eligible voter. Special reports will be presented concerning the church's finances, including the capital campaign and the capital projects and planning team. A summary of the approved budget with more details to be presented in September at our corporation meeting, and the return of the in-person activities committee. Any matter of interest and concern to the church and its work may be properly presented at that meeting by any eligible voter. Signed, David Sung, clerk of session, and Nicole Gray, president of the board of trustees. As I mentioned, if you're worshiping with us virtually, if you're with us on Zoom, stay put. That's where the meeting's happening. If you're on Facebook, there will be a link in the chat to click and send you over to Zoom. Please do that. There will also be a link in the chat if you've not already received it or downloaded it to download the annual report packet, the documents and the agenda for that meeting. If you're here with us in person, and we encourage you to do so, please join us in the lounge to participate in that meeting, and we have some annual reports printed out. Whew. That concludes our announcements this morning. I invite you now to quiet your hearts and your minds as we prepare for worship.
Get together with the Lord. Get together with the Lord.
Where they will
treat each other like sister and brother when they all get together with the Lord.
Now when they
all get together, when they all get together with the Lord,
where they will
treat each other like sister and brother when they all get together with the Lord.
Now when the tall and the small get together with the Lord, get together with the Lord. Well, the weak are no longer afraid of the stronger when they all get together with the Lord.
Now when they all get together, when they all get together with the Lord,
well, they will
treat each other like sister and brother when they all get together with the Lord.
Well, God has no favorites, he just loves us all the same. His Son died to save us and to keep us in his name. And soon we'll rise to meet him, and forever we will reign, and we will sing, 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 sing.
Now when we all get together, when we all get together with the Lord,
well, we will greet each other like sister and brother
when we all get together with the Lord, with the Lord.
Oh, Please be seated. Let us worship the eternal God, the source of love and life, who creates us. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you that many of us can begin to feel that we can connect with one another again after so long apart. We see our communities beginning to become alive again. So many of us can enjoy our families and our friends as the sun rises, the world turns green, and new life continues to grow. Through this time of keeping our distance for so long, we pass by the small opportunities to help others. We spend time considering what example we are setting or what others are thinking of us while not living the moment with those who need us most. We consume ourselves with wondering what others feel and what they think rather than living through prayer asking what you think of us and our actions. Lord, we make excuses as to why giving our time to others is not possible or not safe, rather than working through you to make the most of the time we do have. We continually choose our own wants over your wants for us. Merciful Lord, in our silence, hear our own personal prayers of confession. Loving God, we ask that you continue to lead us in the right direction, and do your good will. Amen.
Friends, let us now hear the good news. We are loved, and we are forgiven. We need not succeed, nor achieve, nor win to receive this divine gift. We need only accept the fact that we are accepted, just as we are, as a beloved child of God. We are then encouraged to live out of this knowing. Sisters and brothers, we are forgiven. Not just some of us, but all of us. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Mustard seed. It is one of the tiniest seeds I have ever seen. It is so tiny that if you were to hold it in your hand and you dropped it on the ground, it would be so difficult to find the seed. The mustard seed is so small, but when it grows into a large, large bush that birds can perch on and make their nests in. Jesus told a parable comparing the mustard seed with the kingdom of God. Jesus said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs and puts forth large branches, so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." When Jesus began his earthly ministry, he had no followers. The Bible tells us that Jesus was walking along the Sea of Galilee when he saw two fishermen, Peter and Andrew, casting their nets. "Come and follow me," Jesus said to them, and they immediately followed Jesus. As they continued on their way, they saw two other brothers, James and John, mending their nets. Jesus called them, and they immediately left their nets and followed him. One by one, Jesus called his disciples until there were 12 of them. That is a pretty small beginning, isn't it? But Jesus sent them, the 12, out, and they brought back others to Jesus, and the kingdom of God grew. From a very small beginning, the kingdom of God grew and grew and grew until it spread over the entire earth. To get a better understanding of what this story teaches, I took an apple and I cut it open and I took out the seeds and I found 5 seeds. So if you imagine we had those 5 seeds and we planted them and 5 apple trees grew up, how many apples do you think we'd have? 50, 100, maybe 200? Well, I read that an apple tree can produce from 150 to 300 apples a year, and that they can produce apples for up to 50 years. That is a whole lot of apples. Just as Jesus started growing the kingdom of God with a handful of disciples, every follower of Jesus is part of the kingdom, and that means that you and I are part of God's kingdom. Each time we tell somebody about Jesus, we are helping to grow the kingdom. Isn't it great to know that we can have a part in growing God's kingdom? Please pray with me. Dear God, I pray that the little mustard seed of faith that you have put within each of us would be true and would continue to grow as we know you better. Amen.
A reading from the book of Mark. Listen for the word of the Lord. He also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself, first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle because the harvest has come." He also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in the shade." With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. The word of the Lord.
Will you pray with me? Almighty God, we give you thanks for gathering us together in this space, however we are gathered. We ask that you would speak to us this day through your Holy Spirit. Move in this place and move in our hearts. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts this morning be pleasing to you, for you, O God, are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So this morning I want to start with a little something different. I kind of want to begin my sermon with the end in mind, and hopefully that makes sense. I want to begin with a question to you all. Now, if you're worshiping with us virtually, I invite you, as you're able, to furiously type any response that you might have into the chat, or if you're on Zoom, you can unmute yourself and share your response there. If you're here with us in person, feel free. I know we're Presbyterians, but share your answers out loud. That's okay with me. At the very least, whether you're here in person or virtually with us, at least make a mental list. What things, in your view, has our world normalized that maybe shouldn't be normal? What things make you say, it doesn't have to be that way? What things, in your view, has our world normalized that maybe shouldn't be normal? What things make you say, it doesn't have to be that way? This is a dramatic pause in case anybody's feeling the spirit.
Racism.
Thank you, Tom.
Political conflict.
Childhood poverty.
Hunger.
All right. If you keep going, my sermon's just going to get longer. It's okay with me. Right? There are all of these things. The list could go on and on. Right? I think maybe it's a little difficult to notice it at times, but we are sitting in the shadow of the past. And some events cast such a large shadow that it's impossible to fathom anything else. Right? And so sometimes we lift up these kinds of things. We think it doesn't have to be this way, but it's just the way that it is. Right? That we are sitting in the shadow of the past. And for example, we sit in the shadow of the age of discovery, for some of you who know what that is, right? So colonialism in our culture is just a fact that we are forced to reckon and wrestle with. We sit in the shadow of the Enlightenment. And so rationalism and empiricism is just the way that knowledge works. We sit in the shadow of chattel slavery. And so institutional racism is just a fact. But these facts were not always facts, right? We created them. We created culture. And in return, culture creates us. As people of faith, I believe that we are invited, and I would even go as far as to say called. We are called to speak and dream and write and imagine and explain and to find joy in a different way. Scripture calls that the kingdom of God. But the question that our scripture reading raises this morning is, well, what exactly does that look like? And again, I'd go as even far as to say that scripture affirms that there are things, aspects of the kingdom of God that are so true, so divine, so beautiful that even the words that we use to describe it actually diminish it. And because there's no perfect way to talk about the kingdom of God, I think that's why Jesus speaks to us and to his followers in parables. Right at the beginning of Mark chapter 4, he says, "Anyone who has ears to hear, let them listen." Now, I don't know if you caught it or not, but there are actually two parables here in our scripture reading this morning. The first is what's called the parable of the growing seed. And the second is the parable of the mustard seed. The first doesn't appear in any of the other gospels, and so it's actually much lesser known. And the second is quite unique from its other occurrences in the gospels of Matthew and Luke. And while they may be lesser known parables, I think they are particularly significant, especially for us today. Together, they discuss our particular roles as Christians in ushering in the kingdom of God. But they also talk about what the kingdom of God is like. All of Mark chapter 4, the parable of the sower, which we know that comes at the beginning of the chapter, we didn't read that one. And these two parables here remind us that the seeds of the kingdom need to be sown. We might not get to determine where the seed falls, that's the parable of the sower, or how the seed grows, that's the parable of the growing seed, but nevertheless, we are indeed invited to sow the seeds. But the emphasis here is not actually on sowing the seeds. In fact, that's the case for all of these seed parables in Mark chapter 4. We sow the seed, but whether or not the seed takes root is up to the soil. We sow the seed, but the seed sprouts and grows naturally on its own. New Testament scholar Lamar Williamson, in his commentary on Mark, suggests that this parable of the growing seed is actually significant for whenever and wherever we Christians take ourselves and our efforts too seriously, seeking by our plans and our programs to bring about the kingdom of God on our own. It's against such arrogant self-importance which stands a subtle allusion to God's hidden presence and power. We are called to sow the seeds of the kingdom, and yet the kingdom grows on its own. And what it looks like, we don't get to determine. We are called to sow the seed. The growing is the mystery of God that cannot be controlled or understood. And I love personally what comes next. I love that Jesus pauses for a moment in between the two parables, and he takes a step back and he kind of says, how can I describe this thing to you? This thing which I know so well in a way that you can understand. As a parent of a five-year-old, I can relate to this predicament, right? So recently, my son Ross, who I had mentioned is five, has become obsessed with his age and with the age of his friends. Am I older than Benny? He'll ask. Benny is Alicia's son, if you didn't know. Yes, bud, I respond. When I get older, will I still be older than Benny? Yeah, Ross, that's kind of how age works. You know, I don't know what else to say. Will I always be older than Benny? Yes, you will always be older than Benny. That's just the way that it works. How can I describe this thing to you in a way that you will understand? Right away, the emphasis that Jesus puts here in this parable, I think we are reminded that understanding the kingdom of God is anything but simple. Even to the extent that we think we have it figured out, I think Scripture forces us, even these parables force us, to acknowledge that it's complicated. And as the saying goes, we don't know what we don't know. And so we have this perfectly imperfect example. The kingdom of God is like a mustard seed, which when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all of the seeds on the earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and it becomes the greatest of all shrubs and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. I think Alicia in her children's message was correct, and I think we understand the metaphor here of sowing the mustard seed, right? Empowered by the Holy Spirit, even our smallest acts of compassion and justice and love and welcome can have a huge impact. But I also think there's something else here, something significant about the kingdom of God that I don't want us to miss. You see, in Mark's telling of this parable, the mustard seed doesn't grow into a huge tree, as is the case in other gospels, but rather it's a large shrub. In the ancient Near East, mustard was actually considered an invasive weed, a bushy shrub that could take over your field. In fact, in his book, God is Green, an Eco-Spirituality of Incarnate Compassion, author Robert Shore Goss states that the mustard seed, or mustard, was considered actually an unclean weed. It wouldn't have been planted in a field or in a garden, and it actually would have been prohibited and considered foolish to do so. All right, so why would you plant a mustard seed in your field, we might ask Jesus? Why would you want to plant a weed in your field that invites pests and birds, right? Birds eat other seeds. Have you ever tried to put grass seed in your yard? They drive me crazy. And it grows to be this large, bushy shrub that blocks the sun from the rest of your field. Why would anyone do that? I think any hearer of Jesus' parable in that day would never have scattered mustard seed in their field. And yet we're reminded here in this text that the kingdom of God is a mystery, whose realization comes as a surprise in the most unexpected ways. It's a place where the least expected are always welcomed and sustained and nourished, where the birds of the air can nest and where they grow to be a blessing to others. But if we're not careful, here's the caution, right? If we're not careful, we'll miss it. Perhaps we'll mistake the kingdom of God for a weed and pull it out. In science fiction, the word terraform refers to the process of transforming another planet so as to resemble Earth, particularly so that it can sustain and support human life. In his book, which I've conveniently taken the title of my sermon from, I borrowed it, we don't steal, we borrow, Christian hip-hop artist Propaganda asks this. He says, what if we apply this idea of terraforming, that is, transforming a planet in order to sustain life, to our world today? What if you could terraform the culture, your family, your inner world, yourself? What if the interplanetary scientists and engineers were actually human being artists and songwriters and poets? Let me take that metaphor even further, he goes on. What if we thought about our cultural climate in the same way that we consider the actual climate? And the harvestable ground was actually represented by the ideas that we plant in others' hearts and minds. What if the air that we breathe was represented by the songs and the poems and the stories which we sing over one another? What if our words created worlds? Now here's the gut punch. That's exactly what we've been doing the whole time. This is where we get back to the beginning. As human beings, from the very beginning of the creation, right, we have been terraforming. In fact, I would even suggest that is in part what it means to be created in the image of God. Unfortunately, too often, I think we've mistaken the mustard seed for an unwanted weed and have instead sown seeds of power and glory and greed and injustice and you name it. As a result, we turn on the TV, right, and headline after headline after headline tells another story of police violence or the demonization of LGBTQ persons, or of another refugee crisis, or the exploitation of the ecosystems which sustain us, or childhood poverty, or racism, or political division, or any of those things that we mentioned. And we despair and we mourn at the nature of their chaos and their senselessness. But here's the thing. I don't think that these things are either random or senseless. They're not weeds that crop up overnight. They are carefully planted, curated realities. They are choices that we all have made. They're the seeds that we have sown. And these headline-making choices will not be overturned easily. They require a rethinking of everything. I think that's what Jesus is getting at with this parable. The kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. Now hear me out, Jesus might have said. I know it sounds crazy. The kingdom of God is like a mustard seed when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all of the seeds on the earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and it becomes the greatest of all shrubs. And it puts forth large branches so as to sustain and nurture life. What things, in your view, has our world normalized that maybe shouldn't be normal? What are those things that make you say it doesn't have to be that way? I think these parables invite us to be and to become terraformers. I love that word. Those who can reshape our homes and our neighborhoods and our friendships and relationships and communities by the power of the Holy Spirit. What is preposterous but could be incredible? What is obvious but we don't see it? What is already here? What do we already know? What do we need? How should we treat each other? Terraform. That's the kingdom of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. And invite you to join us in singing our hymn of response. It's number 69 in the hymnal, the red hymnal.
Let us join our hearts and minds together in prayer. Let us pray. Holy One, you hold the mysteries of the universe. You transform shepherds into kings and the smallest seeds into magnificent, unexpected bushes. You anoint us with living water to grow in peace and love that we might serve the world. Yet sometimes we become aware of an empty space within. aware that we need this time to be in quiet communion with you. So we pause for a moment to just be, to breathe into a holy silence. Loving God, while we are comforted in our needs by the knowledge of your presence, you also challenge us. You often shake us out of our comfortable ways of thinking and acting. You compel us to look at and reorder the priorities in our lives. We are often not comfortable with Jesus' words and actions, for they shine a light on how we may not be supporting those at the margins through our own words and actions. God, continue to make us uncomfortable as we trust that we are not in that space alone. For you guide and hold and invite us into curiosity about how our histories intertwine with others. You guide and hold and invite us into curiosity about how we might build an equitable future for all your beloved children. Lord, we also bring to you this morning our own personal prayers that are on our hearts. For the lonely, the worried, the grieving, the sick, for whatever challenges or joys we or those we love are experiencing right now, we lift them up to you now in the silence. Holy One, guide us in continuing the strong bonds of caring support within this church family, that we might continue the centuries-long commitment to minister to others and each other in your strong name. We ask these things with the prayer our Savior Jesus Christ taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Each of us has talents to share and resources to invest in God's service. In thankfulness, let us bring our gifts and ourselves as our offering to God. There are numerous ways to do so. Through the blue donate link on our church website, through a link in the chat, by sending a check through the mail, or for those here in person, as Kyle mentioned, by placing an offering in the plate near the exit on your way out. Also, by sharing your time and talents through the many opportunities happening at the church. These can be found in the worship bulletin and on the church website. Today, in addition to our normal offering, a reminder that we receive a special offering for Samaritan Baptist Church's Vacation Bible School. So let us now reflect and share our offerings to God.
Trust and obey. Trust and obey. There's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy God, magnificent and sustaining farmer of your kingdom, receive these gifts of time, talent, treasure, and of our very selves, we pray. Through our offering, help us to know in some surprising way that you are bringing into being something wonderful and new. In Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Friends, God calls us in surprising ways, inviting us into a new creation that is the kingdom of God. And so this day and every day, we're invited to share that good news with one another. And in this moment in particular, we invite you to share that through a sign of Christ's peace. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Invite you, if you are present here, to share a sign with one another, socially distant. If you're worshiping with us virtually, please share a sign of Christ's peace in the chat or by unmuting yourselves on Zoom. I'm going to type into Facebook chat here. We invite you to join us in our closing hymn, which is hymn number 313, and it's verses 1, 2, and 4. Red hymnal. Reminder, if you're with us on Zoom, stay put. If you're with us on Facebook, use the link in the chat. Hopefully we will reshare that now to jump over to Zoom to join us for our congregational meeting. And if you are worshiping with us here in the meeting house, please join us in the lounge. Friends, I invite you to feel the love of God this morning growing in each one of our hearts. I invite you to go from this place to sow seeds of love and mercy and joy and peace wherever you may be, in all that you say and all that you do. And now may the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, which binds us all together, be with us this day and always. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Jesus, ruler of all nature. I'm good. How are you doing?
Oh,
yeah. We have a little group of faculty members who play over here.
Yes, it was very well done.
It was good that they could have it.